to the sixth day of this Spanish part, the 2015 Winter Universiad. The spectacular sights of the Sierra Nevada proving to be an inspiration to all involved in this Granada showpiece. On the menu we have the second part of the men's super combined competition from Sierra Nevada. The figure skating comes to a climax at the Granada Igloo as the ladies show off their artistry to the full with their free programs. And Canada look to make up for their poor start in the men's curling competition, looking to make up for lost ground against a very solid looking Russian quartet. This afternoon, the men were back on the Universiad piste for the second part of the super combined competition. Michelangelo Tentori unsurprisingly leading the way after the Super G in the morning, but looking nervously over his shoulder at the technical specialists looking to chase him down through the 54 turns. Perfect conditions too up in the Sierra Nevada for this one. Matej Falat of Slovakia was sitting in 10th place after the Super G, over 1.5 seconds off the lead. This his 22nd birthday today. He was 13th in the Super G earlier in the Universiad, 9th in the slalom in Trentino, so expecting to move up the leaderboard if he could produce a good clean run. Carving his way nicely between the gates. Keeping his momentum going too through the second half of the run, nearly falling over the front of his ski there. Going nicely through the transition to over the finish line. Nearly 2 seconds into the lead for Falak, but he knows there are 9 men to come after him. He'll be expecting to be nudged down the order as the race progresses. Sandro Bona with a 0.3 second lead over Falak, coming into this one having been 8th in the morning Super G. Had a bit of a letdown for the Swiss, having taken a bronze medal in the Super G competition earlier in the week. He also won the Super G back in 2009 in China. The Universiad, which he also won this super combined competition, so certainly hopeful of making up time in the slalom. The 27-year-old really attacking the course, he knows he has to. Getting as close as he dare to the gates and putting in a fantastic run. 44.32 seconds in the end for the slalom. The third fastest of the day, in fact, and enough to put him into first place, over 0.3 second, ahead of Falat. Guido Boschka of Italy, second after the Super G. Didn't, in fact, race the Super G here in the Sierra Nevada in 2015. Came sixth in the Super G, though, in Trentino, where he also won a silver medal in the giant slalom. Did well in the morning after nearly losing his balance at the top of the piste, recovered to be just 0.4 second behind his compatriot after the first leg of this super combined. Again, really attacking the piste as he knows he has to. Trying to keep up with Bona. Through the transition, nearly losing an edge there. And over the line, 45.48 seconds, only the 8th fastest slalom, but enough to put him up into 2nd place, 0.35 behind Bona, with just this man to come, Michelangelo Tentori. Very much the form man in the Sierra Nevada this year. Won the Super G in the opening men's event of the Alpine programme. Tentori also the fastest man down in the Super G in the morning. And deciding attack being his best course down the piste. Certainly not holding back and defending. Looking a little ragged though. Eventually this would catch him out. Also finding himself a little airborne in some of these turns, losing speed. Then disaster struck near the bottom of the piste. Catching an edge, missing a gate. The Italian deciding to crab back up the piste to make sure that he finishes the race at least. There you see the problem. Tintori did at least eventually finish the course, although 10 seconds down from everyone else. A huge letdown for the Italian. So Bernard delighted to have become just the second man to triumph twice in this discipline, following the footsteps of Czech skier Peter Jurko in 1987 and 1991. This also the first Swiss gold at this year's Universiade. The ladies took to the ice in the Granada Igloo as the figure skating competition came to a climax with the ladies' free programme, with the Russians well-placed to claim this title for the seventh time in Universiade history and continue their domination of the medal table in 2015. Maria Artemyeva of Russia was sat in second place after the short programme, having scored 62.11 points. The 21-year-old getting off to a great start there with a triple Lutz double toe loop combination. That the big start required, but her routine rather unravelling as she hit the ice after that triple toe loop. Artemyeva, eighth in this year's Russian Championships and seventh at the Universiade in 2013 back in Trentino. And stepping out there of her double axle, double toe loop combination as well. A few mistakes creeping into her routine, but still the technical content high enough to ensure that she would still be challenging for a medal. Great artistry being shown by the 21-year-old. Always sure to catch the eyes of the judges. The programme spinning to a climax, worth 108.13 points, her personal best for a free programme. An overall total of 170.24 points, also a personal best. Ome Berenice Miette of France was sitting in fourth place after the short programme, having scored a rather disappointing for her 56.84 points. Miette, the French champion in 2014 and 2015. Very powerful skater, as you can see there. Great height going into those jumps and with the strength to land them as well. Even managing a triple combination on that one. A triple Schalke, double toe loop, double toe loop. Not many women skaters in the world could carry that one out. A 20-year-old maturing as a skater too. More and more artistry coming into her programmes as the years go by. She was fifth in last year's European Championships and sixth in the Europeans in Stockholm just a week before this Universiade. 20-year-old from the University of Montpellier, also 10th at the 2014 Olympics. Miette also fluent in both Spanish and English, sure to be getting plenty of chances to practice her linguistic skills here in Granada. And a lovely change foot combination spin to finish off her programme. Really fly up the leaderboard with a score of 114.70 points, a total of 171.54, putting her just ahead of Artemyeva. Well, the hot favourite for the title, Elena Leonova of Russia, leading the way after the short programme. Just the one mistake in her free programme coming there right at the start. the second part of her triple toe loop, triple toe loop combination. But after that, the 24-year-old from Leskav University in St. Petersburg, all but flawless. This her Universiad debut, and she was promising a very romantic and expressive tango. This is the first time that she's unleashed this program on the public. Full of great technical content and artistry as well. And over ninth in the 2010 Olympics. 2 years later, she got a silver medal at the World Championships as well in Nice. She's also a former world junior champion from 6 years ago. She said that she came here to give the best of herself and to try and be the best. She's certainly carrying on the great tradition of Russian figure skating. Sofia Buryukova won this event in Trentino for Russia. So great footsteps to be following in for Leonova. A rousing finish to that program, 115.73 points by far, putting her into the lead, 182.85 in the end. A deserved champion, Leonova, the Russian, very much the class of the field, taking the gold medal by a comfortable margin of over 10 points. Our medalists head and shoulders above the rest of the Universiad field, with third place Artemieva 15 points clear, or fourth place Frenchwoman Laurine Lecavalier. Italy's Roberta Guadagnaro in fifth after rather falling apart in the free skate. Now to the men's curling competition and the fifth session from the Fontanova Pavilion, which saw Russia take on Canada. The Russians coming into the match with a 3-1 record, having beaten Sweden, the USA and Team GB, but lost to Norway. Meanwhile, the Canadians in big trouble with a 1-3 record. They'd lost to the USA, GB and Switzerland, with only one win coming up against the Czech Republic. Well, the first end was a stalemate, Canada choosing not to score a single. So here we are in the second end with the last of the Russian stones, just trying to flick off the stone on the left, but just missing the cannon, leaving Canada in good shape to score two from the second end, which was exactly what they were looking for. A simple draw for skip Matt Dunstan. Plenty of sweeping going on. And that stone eventually just creeping into scoring position, putting Canada 2-0 up. Well, Canada then stole a stone in both the third and fourth ends to make it a 4-0 lead. The Russians got one back in the fifth to make it 4-1. Now into the sixth end, the Russians with their final stone of the end, looking for a draw into the house, already lying three. Evgeny Akhipov with a deft touch. That stone pretty much on the button. Leaving the Canadians now with a takeout. Looking to cannon off the leftmost stone and then deflect across onto the second scoring stone as well. Just hit the wrong side though, leaving the Russians scoring two. The score's back to 4-3. The Canadians then took another stone in the seventh to make it 5-3 into the eighth end. Akhipov's first stone of this end. Drawing this one in. Cannoning off the centralmost Canadian stone, leaving the Russians lying two for the moment with just the final stones of the end to go. Dunstan going with pace this time, looking to take out that middle stone and cannon across, just not quite a heavy enough contact though. That leaving Akhipov with a chance of a simple draw for a double. These two skips more than familiar with each other before. They met in the 2013 World Junior Championships. The Canadians prevailing in the group stage, the Russians winning their semi-final. Going on to take the silver medal there, while the Canadians made do with bronze. Into the ninth end. The Russians looking to bump the Canadian stones at the back of the house, currently in scoring positions. Not getting a full enough contact though. Markipov's own stone dropping out of the house. Canada lying one. A simple draw for a double. All he has to do is avoid that front guard. And doing so with ease as well. So another double for Canada and a 7-5 lead going into the final end. So the pressure very much on the Russians. They needed two now to force extra ends in this match. Canadians with their final stone looking to draw around the front guard and leave their stone in scoring position. Some heavy sweeping going on. But perfectly drawn by Dunstan in behind that guard. Now a very tricky cannon shot for Arkhipov to keep their game alive. Looking to use his own guard to cannon into that Canadian stone and from there onto those other stones at the back of the house. Not quite getting the right angle though, just missing that Canadian stone. And with that, two scoring for the Canadians, a 9-5 victory for them. Much needed as well if they want to go any further in this competition. The Russians now with a 3-2 record after five matches. The Canadians with a 2-3 record after a 9-5 victory.
Education meets sport and culture.
On your mark.
What best promotes excellence in mind and body? Where do friendship, integrity, and achievement meet? Which event gathers the best student athletes from around the world? The Universiade, the home of international university sports. Today's stars, tomorrow's leaders.